Hello everyone, welcome to this session on cybersecurity. In this session, we are going to look at the legal perspective of cyber crimes as well as cyber crime from Indian perspective as well as global perspective, that is worldwide. So first let's look at cyber crime, the legal perspectives. So this is like historical data, very old things. The first comprehensive presentation of computer crime is titled as Computer Crime Criminal Justice Resource Manual. It is in the year 1979, so it is very old. So in that document, they defined computer crime as any illegal act for which knowledge of computer technology is essential for a successful prosecution. So basically, it boils down to doing bad things or illegal things using computer or computer technology. And there was another study which is about international legal aspects of computer crimes, and it is in the year 1983. So in that study, they defined computer crime as which encompasses an illegal act for which knowledge of computer technology is essential for its perpetration. So this also refers to doing illegal things using computers. And if you consider globalized information systems, they can accommodate a number of transnational offenses, that is offenses across different nations. So globalized information systems, you can take examples of Facebook, Instagram, you can take Gmail, Dropbox, and all these things. Since they are used by people across the world, they can be considered as globalized information systems. And particularly the network aspect gives rise to number of globalized offenses. Okay, all the systems are connected to the network, and anyone sitting anywhere in the world can access this network and commit offenses. And such problems can be resolved in two ways. One is to divide information systems into segments bordered by state boundaries. That is, let's say if you are the owner of Facebook, you will have one branch in one country, another branch in another country. Like that, if you have users across 30 to 40 countries, in each country you will have one building, okay, that is a branch, and you have to hire several people for all those branches. And this seems to be impractical solution. Why? It is very difficult to maintain that many branches or buildings across all the countries. So another plausible solution is to incorporate the legal system into an integrated entity. That is, across each country there should be a legal system, that is, which overlooks all the kinds of offenses and punish them or prosecute them. Now we are going to talk about cybercrime from Indian perspective. So you can see India is the second highest number of is the country which has the second highest number of internet users, and this is based on 2017 statistics. Right now also it is the second highest country having the second highest number of internet users, and the first country you can assume it is China. And in India, most of the internet access happens from cyber caves. I would like to reiterate again, this is old information. Right now, most of the internet access happens from mobiles. So in a family, all the persons, even kids, are having their mobiles, and they are able to access internet from mobiles. And the typical age group of most Indian internet users falls between 18 to 35 years. This is true now also. and we will talk about this Information Technology Act, IT Act, in the coming slides. Okay, according to that, there was a 50% increase in the crimes from 2006 to 2007. It's a drastic increase, and I have included this to just tell about different cyber crimes in India in the period of 2017 to 2016. So just pause the video and have a look of this picture. So majority of the crimes being committed are for online banking, and you can see Facebook related crimes, email hacking, sexual harassment, lottery fraud, data theft, etc., etc. And lastly, I would like to focus on the increase in the number of crimes from 2016 to 2017. And let's continue. So most of the people who are committing crimes are under 30 years. That is, they are teenage people. Okay, and the Indian government is striving hard for controlling these cyber crimes. And so as an example, you can see here Delhi police are training their officers to detect and investigate cyber crimes. Okay, not only Delhi police, across the India, most of the branches, that is police, they are training their own officers regarding this cyber crime. And now we are going to talk about cybercrime and the Indian ITA 2000 Act, that is the Information Technology Act 2000. Okay, and it was brought into practice after this United Nations General Assembly resolution, the details, in January 30, 1997. And it was done by adopting the model law on electronic commerce, which was adopted by the United Nations Commission on International Trade Law. So this model law on electronic commerce is the first step towards the law relating to e-commerce at international level. So e-commerce is an alternative to the real world commerce. So to regularize that, they have created this new law, model law on electronic commerce. Okay, so that law was brought into practice taking into consideration this unilateral model of law on electronic commerce in 1996. And cyber crimes in India are punishable under two categories. One is the Information Technology Act 2000, as well as IPC, Indian Penal Code. Okay, so based on the IT Act, 207 cases of cyber crime were registered. Okay, and when compared to that, there are 142 cases which were registered under ITA in 2006. So you can see the increase from 142 to 207. Okay, and under IPC, Indian Penal Code, the number of cases that were registered is 311 in 2006, and it was increased to 39 in 2007. Okay, and the ITA 2000 is updated in 2008. Okay, and I included this picture to show you the number of cases that are being booked under IPC and ITA. So this yellow bars represent number of cases registered under ITA, and the red ones represent number of cases registered under IPC. So you can see the number of cases are increasing exponentially, and this is data only up to 2013. So you can assume the number of cases increasing. Okay. And now a global perspective. Okay. So like ITA in India, we have Cybercrime Act 2001 in Australia. And similarly, Cybercrime Treaty in Europe. Okay. And some points, the spam legislation mentions none about India as far as email legislation in India is concerned. That is, whatever things are mentioned for email, that is controlling the email, there is nothing mentioned about spam. So even if you spam email to a lot of people, you are not going to be punished. Okay. This is not true right now. This is old information. Right now, everything is punished. So be careful while doing things. The legislation refers to India as loose legislation. That is, even if you commit spam and email related frauds, you are free. Okay. And you can escape. There are some loopholes. That is what this refers to. Okay. Right. About 30 countries have done something regarding this anti-spam legislation, and there are also technical solutions available which are provided by internet service providers for controlling spam. So even though there are all these things, there is no significant impact on the volume of spam. Right now, most of the email in the internet, let's say around 40 to 50% of the email is spam, and the spam is used to support criminal activities. Like I explained in the previous sessions, spam is one of the channel through which criminal activities are conducted, like phishing. Okay. So this is interesting. Just see this picture. So this blue chunk refers to revenues earned through selling data in the illegal online markets. So there is something called dark web. I will show you at the end of the session. So typically what do these criminals or hackers do is they steal the data in the databases or hard disks or somewhere else, and they sell that data in the black markets in the internet, and that is called dark web. So majority of the income earned by the cyber criminals is through selling data in the illegal online markets. And then second chunk refers to selling trade secrets and intellectual property theft. Okay, this data belongs to the organizations or companies. So these criminals steal the trade secrets in the form of documents and the intellectual property related information, and they sell it to other people. And this green chunk refers to data trading. Okay, and this small part is divided into two things. One is crime as a service, that is people provide different hacking techniques or methods as services. For example, one such kind of service is DDoS, distributed denial of service. So you can find these services on the internet. So if you just simply want to take down a server, you go and purchase this DDoS service. You give the target URL or IP address, and you hit submit, and the website will perform a DDoS on the target. Okay, so this is called crime as a service. And the remaining portion is revenues from ransomware. So this is about ransomware. So what is ransomware? It is a form of malware. Okay, So it's a piece of code which enters our system generally through emails or phishing mails, or if you are visiting some malicious websites. Okay, generally many of the people visit adult websites, right? And those websites are already implanted with ransomware. So when you visit such websites, the ransomware will come into your system. It will install on your system and it will typically lock the files. Okay, so whenever you want to open your files on the computer, they won't open, and instead they will ask you ransom, that is money. So when you pay the money, the cyber criminal or hacker will send you the key to unlock your files. Okay, in some cases, even if you pay them, they are not going to send you any key. Okay, so what do you do then? You have to format your hard disk, again install the operating system, so all your files will be gone. So this infographic is for your information, so pause the video and have a look at this. Some interesting facts are there, and you can see this infographic says 230,000 new malware samples are produced every day. So a lot of people are not having any work to do, so instead they are developing this new malware and spreading across the internet. And this figure, this is according to research from a firm called Panda Security. And about 51% of all this malware is trojans. Okay, trojan is also a type of malware. Okay, now we are going to discuss about cybercrime and the extended enterprise. So what is this term extended enterprise means? It's a combination of different entities like employees of the company, the board members and top level executives, the business partners, that is third parties, and also the suppliers of raw materials and customers. Okay, so an extended enterprise contains all these entities. They are working together. Okay, and you can define an extended enterprise as loosely coupled and self-organizing network. Okay, so why it is called loosely coupled means there are different categories of entities. For example, if you consider employees, okay, the employees themselves are tightly coupled, but if you consider employees and business partners, they are loosely coupled. Okay, so employees have their own interests and business partners have their own interests. So this is like a overview of an extended enterprise. So all the entities have their own core competencies, and there are strategic alliances with other third parties, and we have, and the enterprise will have customer partnership, and the extended enterprise will outsource some of their work to some other organizations, and there is virtual integration of different services. Okay, so that is an extended enterprise. So in such kind of extended enterprise where lot of entities are there, so how can security be achieved is only through full awareness of existing threats and dangers. So all the entities like employees, board members, customers, and all these entities should have full awareness about what are the different threats and dangers. Only then the security of the entire extended enterprise can be achieved. Okay, so for that, international cooperation at various levels is required. Okay, right, and finally we are going to talk about netizens. So what is a netizen? Netizen refers to internet user. So myself, I am a netizen, you are a netizen, you are currently watching this video through internet, so you are a netizen. We use Facebook, Instagram and all these things. Okay, and the term was coined by the person Michael Oben. Okay, so netizen spends considerable amount of time on online, so that is true. Okay, and for such kind of people, for maintaining online security, the 5 P's, that is protection technology, is one is precaution, prevention, protection, preservation, and perseverance. So these are the 5 P's necessary for the online security. And there is an organization called NASCOM. They continuously tell that cybercrime awareness is required. Okay, and there are different agencies across India and across the globe who continuously tell the people to follow cyber security measures to protect themselves online. Okay, and that's it about netizens. And finally, I would like to conclude the session with this picture and another picture about the cyber security trends. Let's first look at this. So the internet, you know, is can be broadly divided into 3 parts. One is the surface web, which most of the people use. So the surface web contains applications like Facebook, Yahoo, Google, the Bing search engine, Instagram, Dropbox, YouTube, and all these applications. So that is called surface web. Okay, but it represents only 4% of the internet. Okay, and majority portion of the internet, around 90%, is called deep web. Okay, so it contains a lot of information like legal documents, government records, scientific reports, academic records if you consider education, financial records if you consider companies and organizations. So all this data is available in the network, but it is not visible in the search engines. Okay, not visible in the search engines, but they are available in the network. And another 6% of the internet is called dark web, where most of the illegal activities and illegal trading takes place. So either it is drugs, or it is illegal information, or selling and buying data from each other takes place on dark web. Okay, for accessing dark web, we need special kind of software. Okay, so that's it. And I would like to conclude the session with cyber security trends in India in 2019. So you can have a pause now and you can go through these trends. So that's it for today. Thank you.